بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. الحمد لله، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. الحمد لله. We're still discussing on the how we are going to approach positive Islamic cognitive behavior therapy framework and protocol, and we have explained in detail the idea of how we can begin with intention as the baseline, then the intervention, and then we will discuss attitudinal and values transformation and development within the framework of positive Islamic cognitive behavior therapy. And the whole idea is how we're going to develop within ourselves and our patient self-actualization so that we can then help them overcome their problems and then let them able to lead a good, healthy, wonderful life. So I have explained to you the CBT approach and the MBCT and DBT approach and how they are different from our SEMP integration for PI-CBT. And we have other approach like biomedical, bioherbal, and so on. So the history of Islamic psychological intervention is also very deep in terms of the use of herbs. For example, we know, for example, in the good old days, they have been using cannabis, for example, as a herbal remedy. All right, the same thing with opiate, the various kind of opium and its derivatives, either by inhaling or by smoke or by any other traditional way, infusion and so on. But naturally, this approach then allow the drug industry to develop a synthetic analog, opiates and so on, which then they sell as a way forward in terms of the biomedical approach. Okay, so in Islam, I think for positive Islamic cognitive behavior therapy, we must use both. That means our intervention should be from the perspective of psychotherapy plus herbal intervention plus, for example, bio medical using even synthetic drugs. There's a lot of research doing that is being done right now in terms of developing of new drugs that is genetically modified, many approach using various means of biomedical pharmacological approach, which is very useful. So inshallah, we do not deny all that, but we should work concurrently. That means if we are going to tackle the problem of the psychological problem of this world in terms of all the whole range of spectrum of psychological disorders, we must be able to intervene at various level. Apart from psychotherapy, positive Islamic cognitive behavior therapy, and apart from the approach, bioherbal approach, which we can intervene. There's many research in terms of bioherbal approach, which now also being practiced in the West. We should embrace that and also bring it together with our PI-CBT and the biomedical approach. So I'm going to show you a short video of the biomedical approach, biopharmacological, including also electroconvulsive and also the biomagnetic approach now that is being used, inshallah.
Physiologically change the brain's electrochemical state with psychotropic drugs, magnetic impulses, or even electrical currents in surgery. As you might expect, pharmacotherapy is by far the most widely used. That's the one where you just take drugs. Psychotropic drugs are just any pharmaceutical that affects your mental state. The most commonly used ones fall into four major categories: antipsychotics, anxiolytics, antidepressants, and mood stabilizers, each aimed at a specific family of problems. Antipsychotics are used to treat schizophrenia and other types of severe thought disorders. Most of these medications alter the effects of the neurotransmitter dopamine in the brain by blocking its receptor sites and blocking its uptake. This is based on the assumption that an overactive dopamine system contributes to schizophrenia, but like many psychotropic drugs, antipsychotics come with nasty side effects. Anxiolytics, or anti-anxiety meds, usually work by depressing activity in the central nervous system, much like a stiff drink might. For this reason and others, it can be super dangerous to mix certain anxiety meds with booze. Also, letting your nerves mellow out can feel so good that patients may risk becoming addicted to some anxiolytics. Antidepressants are used to treat depression, as you might expect, but also a number of anxiety disorders. Each type is thought to work a bit differently, mainly by altering the availability of various neurotransmitters like serotonin and norepinephrine in the brain, which which in turn appears to help with mood and anxiety problems. Some of the most common are selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, or SSRIs, like Zoloft, Paxil, and Prozac, which partially block the normal reuptake of serotonin. This makes it more available to the synapses, which, hypothetically at least, allows its mood-enhancing effects to kick in. Current research suggests that the use of antidepressant medication is most effective when combined with psychotherapy, which makes a lot of sense, and the same goes for a number of other psychological disorders. It's worth pointing out here that some meta-analyses suggest that antidepressants aren't any more effective than psychotherapy when symptoms are mild to moderate. One meta-analysis that riled people up in recent years even suggested that antidepressants are no better than a placebo in those cases. So psychotropic drugs can help, but sometimes you also need to start exploring the root causes of your issues and reevaluate how you deal with them, which is what psychotherapy is perfect for. Bernice, for example, probably would have benefited from both talk therapy and a dose of anxiolytic or antidepressant meds. The last big psychotropic drug group is the mood stabilizers. They can be extremely effective in smoothing out the highs and lows of bipolar disorder. Simple salts of lithium were the first of these drugs used, and they remain in widespread use today. Dr. K. Redfield Jameson, who we talked about a few weeks ago, has said that lithium prevents my disastrous highs, diminishes my depressions, gentles me out, keeps me from ruining my career and relationships, keeps me out of the hospital and alive. And while drugs are the most popular biomedical treatment, they aren't the only kind. For one, there's electroshock therapy. Now, hear me out. This does carry a long history of negative connotations, like of people being strapped down and shocked into mental oblivion, but the technology has made a comeback and can actually be quite effective in treating severe treatment-resistant depression. It's properly called electroconvulsive therapy, or ECT, and it involves sending a brief electrical current through the brain of an anesthetized patient. This excites the neurons, causing them to fire rapidly until the patient goes through a small, controlled seizure that lasts about 2 minutes. And we're not exactly sure why this helps relieve negative symptoms, but there are several theories that are being pursued. One suggests that the resulting seizure beneficially alters neurotransmitter activity in areas of the brain associated with moods and emotions, effectively jump-starting a severely depressed brain. Another theory suggests that these electrical impulses modify stress hormone activity in the brain, which we know could play a role in sleep, energy, appetite, and mood. ECT may also reactivate previously dormant or suppressed neurons, or possibly stimulate the growth of new ones in key brain regions, helping the brain regain some level of lost functioning. There are a couple of other brain stimulation treatments, too, that are more gentle. One is repetitive transcranial magnetic stimulation, RTMS, which involves the painless application of repeated electromagnetic pulses. Another, deep brain stimulation, DBS, is more invasive and calls for surgically implanting a kind of brain pacemaker that sends out electrical impulses to specific parts of the brain. Despite all the new research and often positive results around RTMS and DBS, we're still sorting out how these treatments work to heal the brain and mind, but they're hypothesized to jumpstart the neural circuitry in a depressed brain similarly to ECT. So you'll notice that all these options come with certain risks, and really, no treatment is entirely risk-free, perhaps not even psychotherapy. But we should also note that some of the less severe manifestations of psychological disorder may be improved with pretty simple lifestyle changes. 30 to 60 minutes of daily aerobic exercise has been shown to be as effective as antidepressant medications in research on mild depression. Just remember those words, daily and aerobic. Adequate sleep, social interaction, and good nutrition also all play a part in managing moods. In other words, general healthy living helps. There's an old English proverb that says different sores have different salves, and the same is true here. What works for one person may not work for another, and sometimes a few different kinds of intervention might be needed all at once. Today, you learned how client and clinician perceptions, outcome research, and meta-analytic reviews work together to determine the efficacy and effectiveness of psychological treatments. You also learned how biomedical therapies work, including the four major families of drug therapies, along with electroconvulsive therapy, repetitive transcranial magnetic stimulation, and deep brain stimulation, and also how lifestyle changes and general healthy living can improve mental health. Thanks for watching, especially to all of our Subbable subscribers who make Crash Course.
Okay, Alhamdulillah, we have described this approach in terms of biomedical and pharmacological, and it is a very open system in which, inshallah, we can integrate into our positive Islamic cognitive behavior therapy together with all the medication. And remember, all this biomedical approach, pharmacological approach must be done by a qualified doctor qualified psychiatrists, and they must be board certified medical practitioners. But for us, if we are going to do more of the intervention at so far as the psychotherapy approach, CBT, PI-CBT, and the other approaches, we must try to develop qualified psychological counselors, those who have degree in counseling. But if you want to do more of community intervention insofar as developing, for example, our life coach training program, I have done a video on post-Islamic cognitive behavior therapy life coach program. So you may not be a psychologist, but you can help out in terms of shaping excellence in terms of children development, in terms of family development, in terms of community development, intervention with families having problems within the family structure, problems of intervention with youth having drug addiction, pornographic addiction, computer addiction, computer games addiction, and so on. So those things can be done in a community setting, approached by qualified people, but they need not be psychologists. It's more community coaching, mentoring system where we develop to help out, because if you just want to depend on psychiatrists or psychologists, there are not many of them around, and the problems now is far beyond any individual psychology or far beyond psychology or psychiatry. It is a community effort. So that's why when we develop this whole framework of positive Islamic cognitive behavior therapy, we take in all the other intervention, including the bioherbal approach. There's a lot of it in Ayurveda, in TCM, traditional Chinese medicine. There's also a lot of it in Islamic approach to it, which they need a lot of research and also verification vis-a-vis how they can actually be integrated into biomedical approach. So inshallah, at least from this framework, you understand, we start with intention, then we have understand the intervention, next we'll go into the additional values and transformation, and then self-actualization, which I will then give you an idea, and we'll complete this whole idea of PI-CBT framework and protocol. And then we'll go into the tool sets, the various interventions at the various levels, okay? Examples of them, because if you want to do everything of it, there'll be thousands and thousands of them, especially for CBT alone. There's so many approach to toolkits within this intervention that they have developed, which is a wonderful thing, alhamdulillah. So what we can do is just don't try to invent the wheel, use whatever they have done, modify, and then inshallah we can then leapfrog and develop our protocol, our approach, our framework, which we can present to the world under post-Islamic cognitive behavior therapy, always understanding that our life in this world is ordained by Allah to be His sincere servant and His Khalifa, striving to make ourselves good, helping others to be good, and making the world good, inshallah.